Blackstone Audio presents Mencken, The American Iconoclast by Marion Elizabeth Rodgers. Prologue. Boston, 1926. On the morning of April 5, 1926, a multitude of Harvard and Boston University undergraduates, reporters, and the curious gathered at Brimstone Corner in Boston. Students, many of them clutching magazines, awaited the Baltimore journalist and editor H.L. Mencken. Boston newspapers had already announced his impending fate. One headline blared, "Famous editor defies police. Wants to make test case in courts." Another said, "Mencken, ready for jail, selling magazines here." From curb to curb, the crowd awaited the man who had famously derided Puritanism as the haunting fear that someone, somewhere, may be happy. For more than a quarter of a century, he had assaulted it in a variety of publications, from the Baltimore Herald and the Baltimore Sun papers, to his popular magazines, The Smart Set and The American Mercury, in his 40 books, and in his defense of such authors as Theodore Dreiser. Along the way, he had battled the mentality that had caused Huckleberry Finn to be banned from local libraries. Mencken was a believer in liberty in its wildest and imaginable sense, as he put it, liberty up to the extreme limits of the feasible and tolerable. It was Mencken who had convinced Clarence Darrow to defend John Scopes in the infamous monkey trial the previous hot summer. At issue was not simply Darwin's theory of evolution, but freedom of speech itself, a matter of concern to no one more than Henry Mencken. In a long and varied career as reporter, columnist, author, and literary and social critic, his very existence was committed to the free expression of ideas, no matter how controversial and unpopular. "The two main ideas that run through all my writing," he explained, "whether it be literary criticism or political polemic, are these. I am strongly in favor of liberty, and I hate fraud." Freedom had always been an issue with Mencken. First, at an early age, freedom from his father's choice of a career. Later, as he began to develop as a critic, from the Victorian Puritanism that stifled literature and every aspect of American life. Then from governmental laws that violated civil liberties for whites and blacks. Finally, during the two world wars, from censorship of the press. The Constitution and the Bill of Rights, Mencken believed, were sacred documents that set up clear lines of demarcation that no government should trespass. Now Mencken, as editor of the American Mercury, was embarking on another battle against censorship in a challenge to freedom of speech that the New York Times had likened to a second Scopes trial. Accompanied by Arthur Garfield Hayes, counsel to the American Civil Liberties Union, and with a peddler's license in his pocket, Mencken was about to do battle with the Reverend J. Franklin Chase, secretary of the New England Watch and Ward Society, over one particular article in his magazine. Since its earliest days, Boston had had a history of literary bigotry. Items that Chase censored from Massachusetts readers included Boccaccio's Decameron, Sterne's Tristram Shandy, even lyrics by John Dryden. Among modern publications, they included works by Eugene O'Neill, Theodore Dreiser, and Sherwood Anderson. As Chase said, "A whole high school class of unwedded mothers may be the result of a lascivious book." Chase's tyranny and oppression were indomitable. He seldom appeared in public, simply notifying his committee that he believed certain passages in a given magazine or book were illegal. His influence over the local courts had saved him from ever having to name the offending passages. Consequently, hundreds of volumes were shelved, their authors never given the opportunity to be heard in court. Chase became so adept in his tactics that merchants obeyed the Watch and Ward Society with scarcely a question. The press did not dare criticize the censor. Chase now focused his ammunition on an innocuous but true story that appeared in the April 1926 issue of the American Mercury, written by Herbert Asbury. It told the tale of a prostitute called Hatrack from Farmington, Missouri. Its theme was...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.